seen a lot of changes. And you that are older than me, you've seen even more changes. One of the signs of the in the last days is in the book of Timothy, it says in the last days, they'll say nothing's changed. Ever since our fathers fell asleep, everything's remained the same. If you think things have not changed, you're fulfilling a scripture because that you're being deceived if you can't see the change. Hallelujah. You know, when little Abernathy was born, they looked over at Tasha and said, it's a girl. Amen? We dedicated the little girl today. Well, brother Mike, you know. No, it's a girl. Hallelujah. You know, the Bible says in the last days, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. It says they're ever learning, but never coming to the knowledge of the truth. Ever learning. People are getting think they're getting ever smarter, but they're not coming to the knowledge of the truth. All right. So how do you blow this trumpet? You walk around with a horn in the neighborhood. You'll get arrested for disturbing the peace. So what is this trumpet that we're supposed to blow? I do believe that you are to warn people and tell, you know, the Bible says knowing the times. We're supposed to know what time we're living in. If you ever ask some people, do you think we're in the last days? And they go, no. They're not aware of the time that we live. Bible commands us to know the times and seasons, to know the time. The Bible says it's knowing the time, it's high time to wake out of sleep. Do you think the church is asleep? In a large way, they are. I'd like to just share a little nugget with you before I even start. Do you know there was a time in the Bible that Israel had two tabernacles going on at the same time? I didn't think y'all knew that. I didn't either till just the other day. In the Old Testament, it's prophesied that God will restore the tabernacle of David. We all know about the tabernacle of Moses, right? But there was the tabernacle of David. And in the New Testament, it says that God prophesied that God will restore the tabernacle of David, not Moses. Now, recently, the Jews are offering blood sacrifices again in Israel. They started up blood sacrifices in a temple doing the same thing. They started it back up. That'll have significance in a minute. The tabernacle of Moses was this big outer court. They had an altar. They would sacrifice the lamb. They had a laver where they'd wash. The priest would wash their hands. They would go into this holy place where there was candlesticks, incense burning, a table of showbread. Those things represent. I mean, we break bread in this house with Jesus. I mean, our prayers are like incense going up before the Lord. I mean, that candlestick gives light. I mean, the Holy Spirit gives us gifts that light up and show us what to do. Then, right before this table with the incense was, there was another door you could go through, or veil. And through this veil, only the high priest could go in it. And in there was this Ark of the Covenant, that had the presence of God on it. It was the mercy seat. God's presence would abide on that place. Okay? Now, they had that going on for a long time. How many know we trust in things, in rituals and stuff? In the book of Jeremiah, in the 7th chapter, we find Jeremiah prophesying to Israel. And he's saying, you say, the temple of the Lord, we go to church. Don't ever put your trust and your faith in going to church. Attendance is not what's keeping you current with God. It's your relationship with the Lord. Well, Israel had gotten very backslidden. And God tells me, he says, I see you're going to church. You think because you got the tabernacle, you got the church, that I'm there and it's all good because you go to church. He said, you're committing adultery, you're bearing false witness, you're lying, you're stealing. He says, I see all this. That's not right. And he says, repent or I'm going to deal with you like I did with Shiloh. Now, this is where it gets interesting. Shiloh is when the Israelites one time were fighting the Philistines, which they had fought many times. they sent out 4,000 of their best soldiers. They got slaughtered. Now, when you send in your Green Berets and they take them all out, how many of the rest of the guys feel a little shaken? So they said, well, let's go get the Ark of the Covenant. Let's go get God. We'll take God on the battlefield. I'm going to tell you something. God's never lost a battle, but he's not always showed up for every battle. You'll win it if God shows up. But if God don't show up, you can yell God, God all you want. But they went to battle the next day with the Ark of the Covenant. And 30,000 Israelites were killed. A great slaughter. The Ark of the Covenant was taken by the Philistines as a trophy. They get this trophy and they put it in their temple in front of one of their gods, which is made out of stone. It's got a face of a man. It looks like a fish. The next day they walk in there and this fish-looking man god is falling down, and it looks like it's bowing down in front of the Ark of the Covenant. I know God's got a sense of humor. I can't wait to get. I know He can tell some good ones. So they prop it back up, and the next day they go in there, and now it's fallen and it's all smashed to pieces. And then plagues are breaking out. The Philistines are having all kind of problems, and the Bible says He hits them with hemorrhoids. It sits in the Scripture. I'm provoking. Tell us where it is. Read it. Look it up. It's hilarious. So they say, you know what? We don't want to keep this blessing to ourselves. Let's give it to our neighbors. And they give it to another group of people, and they take it. Oh, thanks. Same thing happens. It says they get hemorrhoids too. It says hemorrhoids, people. That's funny to me. So, and they have plagues and things happening. So what do? They give it to their neighbors. Anyways, it ends up in some guy's property, and it's just sitting there. Years pass. This is the Ark of the Covenant. Well, David comes in, becomes king, and Bible says he's different than other kings. He has Bible says, God said that David was a man after my own heart. David loved God. And he says, you know, Let's find the ark. Let's get the God back in on the scene. So they go looking for the ark and they find it. And these guys find it and they see the Ark of the Covenant and they lift up the lid to look inside. Some of you are going, oh, that was a mistake. Well, see, they didn't know that, people, because they didn't know it's been gone for a while. They didn't know what to do with it. How many of you can lose the things of God? So they look inside this thing, and you know what's inside that box? The law. You know, if you look at the law apart from the mercy seat, it'll kill you. Well, 70 men fell over dead. They put the lid back on and went back and said, it killed us. We don't want nothing to do with that thing. And David's like, man, I don't know if I want to bring that into town. It's killing our people. So David starts research. Well, he goes and gets the ark, and they put it on an ox cart, and they start hauling it into town. They go into this place where they're out the threshing floor, where they're out beating wheat and chaff together and separating. That represents judgment. And they get in this thing, and they hit a pothole, and the thing starts to fall. And some guy reaches up to stabilize it, and he gets killed. You know what they do? They leave it there. It's freaking them out. They're moving it. It's killing them. They're looking inside, it's killing them. David goes home and starts researching people. He starts getting out the scrolls, the Word of God. And he starts studying to finding out what's going on with this ark. Well, first of all, he finds out they never hauled it on a cart. Who did the cart thing? The Philistines. They lost how to even carry the presence of God around. The priests are supposed to carry that, the Levites. So he finds out, oh, the Levites got to do it. So he gets the Levites, and they go get the poles, and they bring it, and they figure out how to handle this thing right. I mean, there's a right way to handle the things of God. You know, the Bible talks about coming in and going out. How many know that when you come into the house of God, there's a way to come in? How many know it's not murmuring and complaining? It's not. Boy, I hope the worship team does my favorite songs. And I'll tell you what, I'm going to... Hope Brother Mike's not long-winded today, because there's a good game on today. That's my favorite team. I'll tell you what, my DVR ain't working right. I'll tell you what. I mean, that's not the way you come into the house. Well, so now David, he's got the Ark of the Covenant, and he's bringing it into town, and he is excited. The people are excited. They're all dancing in the street. Everybody's happy. Well, most of everybody. They're dancing and jumping up and down. He takes off his kingly robes. He just has on his street clothes, so to speak. He looks like a natural person, not a king. And he's dancing and shouting and stuff. And his wife, Michael, she's looking out the window, and she despises him. She's mad. She's all, look at you out there dancing in front of them girls and stuff. And when he comes home, he was happy because the presence of God was coming back. The most precious thing God had ever given them was the Ark of the Covenant. It had his presence on it. It was a physical manifestation of God in the earth. And they were like, and he knew it was precious. He comes home and says, wow, the Ark's back. And she's like, oh, didn't you just strut yourself today? Just out there dancing from all those girls and stuff. And he's like, honey, the Ark's back. God is back in Israel. And it says that she, because she murmured and complained, it says that she was barren. I heard a man of God teaching on this recently, and he said, I believe that from that point on, David didn't touch her. She became barren because he refused to be intimate with her. You know, you can't be intimate with people that aren't intimate with God. That was a defining moment in their relationship. He realized that she wasn't going to go on. She wasn't happy about the greatest thing that had happened in Israel to that day. She was finding fault. He was ecstatic that God's presence had come back to Israel. And he just realized, oh, you're going to be carnal. I can't fellowship you in this. How many of those deeper levels you can go in God? Well, she drew a line that day and said, I ain't going there. And I didn't say he divorced her. He said that she was barren at that point. So what happened? David looks around Israel, around Jerusalem, and he finds the tallest hill around there. They're hills. They're not necessarily mountains. He finds the tallest one. It's called Mount Zion. And he pitched a tent, a canvas tent, people. You know what he did in that tent? He put the Ark of the Covenant. You know what he did in that tent? It didn't have a veil covering it like before. You could actually look at the Ark of the Covenant. And for 40 years, everybody could go into that tent. Everybody had access to the presence. This is Old Testament, guys. There was a grace thing happening in the Old Testament. Kind of missed that, didn't we? But you know what? 6 miles down the road, guess what? There's the tabernacle of Moses. They still had that going on. They were slinging blood and doing all the stuff. But you know what? They had the outer court, the inner court, had all that going on. But they didn't have an ark in the holiest of holies. Why? Because it was in the tabernacle of David. Do you know you can go through all the motions and God not be there? Does this not speak to anybody other than me? I got excited hearing this week. There are people right now going through all the motions, but God is not in the house. He's in the tabernacle of David. He's where everybody has access to. For 40 years, day and night, you know what they did in that tent? They worshiped. They had scribes that wrote things down. Most of the Psalms came from that tent. Called the tent of meetings. It's where they met God. In Psalms 103, where it says, I will dwell in the secret place under the shadow of the Almighty, under his wing. You know how he wrote that? Miss Joan? He was knelt down in front of the Ark of the Covenant, inches away, to the point he looked over, and those cherubims that were covering that ark, the light was shining through, and he could see the shadow of the wing, and that's where he was. That's how close he was to the Ark of the Covenant. And he's writing, I will abide in here forever. I don't know about you, that time I got a little chicken skin on that one. We all have access to the ark, to the presence of God. You know, it's sad in this day and age, there's people still trying to resurrect the Jews right now, trying to resurrect the tabernacle of Moses. You know, a greater ark has come to the earth than the Ark of the Covenant. Amen? He was born in Bethlehem. His name is Jesus. He took away the sins of the world. And when he was crucified on the cross, that veil in the temple was ripped from top to bottom, signifying everybody has access to the Father. God says he's going to restore the tabernacle of David, not Moses. You know, this morning we encountered the tabernacle of David. Was he not in the house? Is he not in the house? Was his presence? Did you not feel his presence? Are y'all cold? Some of y'all look like you're cold. You're cold? A little bit? I tell you, all you that are going through the change of life, sit on the front rows. So for these, it's colder up front. You that are just that are, you know, you're tend to get a little cold. Sit in the back. Them hot flashes are tough, aren't they? Hallelujah. Well, that's amazing. That's just a little nugget. As my son Dan would say, that's a nug. A little nugget. Hallelujah. That's a good one, isn't it? I want to be where the tabernacle of David is. I want to be where God's at. We do a teaching here called Baptism in the Cloud. Basically, you need to be where God's at. I would say if he's not in the tabernacle of Moses, he's in the tabernacle of David. You better change tents if you want to have encounters with him. How do you blow this trumpet? How do you warn the people? Well, glad you asked. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 14 through 16, Jesus says, you're the light of the world. Are you? Jesus said, you are. He said, you're the light of the world. A city is set upon a hill that cannot be hid. You're a city set on a hill. Kind of hard to hide Dallas, isn't it? You ever try? You imagine trying to hide San Diego? It's a city. When it lights up at night, it's kind of hard to hide it. That speaks. The things of God should be so obvious in our life, you can't hide it. A city, a light of the world, a city set on a hill that cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle, put it under a bushel, but on candlesticks, and it gives light unto the all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. People are supposed to look at your life and go, something different about you. So, there's no way you can do the stuff you do. It ain't natural. It's supernatural. They're supposed to, and then it says they glorify God, they give God honor. Well, what is this light? We cut the light off, do we all glow? No. Well, some of us do. What is your light? What is the light that's coming out of you? It's the love of God. It's Jesus. Is Jesus love? If you were to get one word to describe Jesus, I think love would be one of the ones you'd have to put on that list. Your love should shine out. I mean, some people love more than others. Amen? In John 13:34, Jesus said, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another even as, or just like I have loved you, love one another. He tells us we got to love like Jesus. And then he says, by this love, shall all men know you're my disciples. How do people know you're a disciple? Because of the love of God that flows out of you. Because this love will cause you to do things that nobody else will do. This love, this compassion. The Bible says in Mark chapter 5, Mark chapter 1, verse 40, it said a leprous man came up to Jesus and said, will thou make me whole? You know, and Jesus said, I will. And it says he was moved with compassion. See, the love of God, and that says Jesus touched him. I mean, a leprous man is not somebody you want to be hugging on. They can look rough. Some of them can look pretty chewed up. But it says he touched him, and he was cleansed. He was made whole. It says that he was moved with compassion. I love that. Love will move you. Not your love, God's love. Carnal love, it's fickle. It's one day, I love you, baby. You're so... And the next day, carnal love. The next day, I don't even like you. I don't even want to be in the same room with you. That's carnal love. It's fickle. It can take you to the highest heights, but in an hour or the next day, it can take you to the lowest depths. That's carnal love. Carnal love is subject to opinion. It's subject to what's in it for me. What do I get out of it? Carnal love says, hey, I'm going to do this for you, but what are you going to do for me? I don't know if you've been keeping score lately, but I'm way ahead. You know, the Bible says love doesn't keep records. It doesn't know. You know, I've been doing this stuff for you, even though you haven't been doing that much for me. Not that I know that. Well, that's carnal love. But we're talking about the love of God. Jesus said, by this shall all men know you're my disciples, that you love one another. What kind of love? How do we know it's the love of God? Because Jesus said that you got to love like I do. Where did Jesus get his love? From the Father. You can't do this without God. Every day you should wake up and say, God, I'm a cup. Fill me up with your love. I'm a cup. Fill me up with your love. And I will go out and I will give everybody I run into drink. And if I start to run low, I'll stop and let you fill me up. Wouldn't it be great if we had to go back to God all day long? Fill me up. Fill me up. He likes that. He doesn't like to fill us up and then the stuff starts stagnating because we don't share it. How many know the love of God was given to be given? The love of God in you cannot be still. Jeremiah said, your word was shut up in me, and I could not be still. When you have the word of God in you, what does the word of God reveal? It reveals to us God. And when you know who God is and how much God is love, you want to tell people. What's the first thing he did for you? Forgave you. How many of y'all glad to be forgiven? All that stuff, it doesn't exist anymore. Well, I wanted to go tell all my friends right after I got forgiven, hey, I feel really, really good. You should be forgiven. It's a wonderful feeling. Amen? Didn't when you first meet Jesus and experience his love and forgiveness and kindness, you want to go tell somebody? See, that wanting to share that living water, give it to somebody else is natural. It's actually not natural. We're sharing this little baby today. It's natural to want to go around and show everybody. Amen? It's unnatural to have a baby and keep it covered up and not share it with anybody. Hallelujah. You want to show everybody, look what, well, my wife used to say, look what we made. I said, made? In the laboratory. Brendan Mike created a child. Hallelujah. No. It is the miracle of life, isn't it? Man, to think that little guy, little tadpole meets an egg, it starts splitting, and it has divine programming as it's starting to split and multiply to know to put plastic on the end of your fingers called fingernails. That somewhere in all that genetic coding, it doesn't put them up here. Puts them right on the end where they're supposed to be. And puts hair right over your eyebrows where they're supposed to be. And she's got little long eyelashes. Little hairs that come out the end of your... I mean, the genetic programming is amazing. It's God. If you believe that we came from monkeys and all that stuff, you're out there, buddy. You're believing stuff that's way beyond what I can. Your faith is way beyond faith. You're in fantasy. That stuff don't even make sense.
you know, there was a big bang, and there was a pond, and stuff started coming out of the pond, and what made the pond? Oh, wait a minute now. Whoa, you're messing with my theology.
There is a big bang theory. Bang! God created. That was the bang was God created. The heavens and the earth. Hallelujah. All right, so let's talk about this love. By this shall all men know you're my disciples. You have love one for another. This love will move you to pray for people. This love will move you to listen to people that are hurting. This love will cause you to want to get along with the one that's giving you this love. You know, the more time you spend with the Lord and get close to Him, the more you'll be sensitive to what He hears and sees. You know, we all stop when someone's crying. We all stop and go, "You okay? Can I help? What's going on?" We all stop on that one, amen? Well, we should. But you know, most people are crying way before the tears show up. Some people are crying for weeks. Sometimes the tears show up when they're at the end of themselves and they can't contain it anymore. Don't we want, you know, love can pick up on that way before. Usually when they're crying, we waited too long, people. Don't y'all want to be discerning and be so sensitive that you nip it before it develops into a full-blown depression or a full-blown, you know, heartache or heartbroken? Don't you? Well, love the one who loves you more than anything. Get with him, and he will give you ears to hear and eyes to see. You know, an ounce of prevention is better than a pound of cure. I would much rather encounter the healing of God when my heart is being discouraged before it's devastated. Amen? Because we all get discouraged, and then that discouragement can turn into despair, and it just goes on and on till we get depressed, till we, you know, just believe it. Just now it's beyond repair. God's way beyond. He can, you know, in Elijah, and there was a guy in the New Testament, this lady named Mary, she goes, and Martha, she goes, Jesus said, "My brother's really sick. You got to come pray for him. He's really sick. I mean, it's getting close." Jesus said, "I'm on my way." And as Jesus, she went back home, and Jesus ran into some other people that had needs, and he got delayed. And then he shows up at Martha's house and says, "All right, I'm here." And she said, "Well, you know, Lord, thanks, but no thanks. If you'd been here a couple days ago, my brother was alive, but he died." And Jesus says, "Well, that's okay." She's like, "No, Jesus, he died. I had hoped to believe that you could fix it before he died, but he's dead. There's nothing you can do at this point." This is what we need to see. We were singing songs today. I love how Judah and I flow. I don't tell them, they don't tell me. It's amazing week after week how the choreograph of the songs go with the message. Now, for you that think we sit down during the week and figure this all out, no. It's the choreograph of the Lord. Wow, we were singing about songs like that this morning, about don't give up, you know, and the Lord can do this, and da-da-da-da. Yeah, and that's kind of cool. That's good. We're talking about that right now. Martha says, "Hey, if you'd been here earlier, he wouldn't have died." He says, "Hey, I am the resurrection and the life." He thinks that he's inspiring her, but what does she do? She goes, "Yeah, yeah, I know that, yeah, in the resurrection, but hey, that's down the road." He goes, "No, I am right now the resurrection and the life." Still not getting it. She's still not getting it. So he goes out there and he says, "Roll away the stone." And she's like, you know, her response was, "Lord." And you can hear this going on in this. She's like, "What are you not getting here, Jesus? He's dead. I've said it like 5-10 times now." He goes, "I hear you. You keep talking about this resurrection," but she's thinking about an event. He's talking about who he is. We got to start seeing Jesus not as the things of God, not as events, but who he is. He is love. He is the resurrection. So he says, "Roll away the stone." And you know what she says? "Lord, wait a minute. Time out." This is what she says. "He stinketh by now." That's what it says. He stinks. It's been 3 days. He's rotting. You don't, no, don't. Come on. Give him some dignity. You know what? Jesus gets out there and he says, I love this. He says, Lazarus, come forth. Why did he say Lazarus? Why didn't he just say come forth? Had he said come forth, yeah, a whole bunch of folks would have started coming out of there. He says, Lazarus, come forth. Because the resurrection was speaking. Life was speaking to the dead. And the dead had to respond. And Jesus knew that, so he had to be specific. Lazarus, come forth. And this guy starts coming out in grave cloth. He's like a mummy, always wrapped up in grave cloth. And then Jesus says, loose him and let him go. You know, when we get people born again, they're raised from the dead. And you have he quickened who once were dead. Quickened means made alive. And you he made alive, Keith, who once was dead. You used to be a dead guy like me. Both of us, roadkill. But Jesus one day resurrected you and resurrected me. Now the job of the saints is when somebody gets resurrected, we're supposed to help them get them those grave cloths off. You know, you can't run around with those things on. Brand, our job is to help get them things off you so you can get free and move around and get some freedom. You're resurrected. You just got some graves clothes, you know. Hello? As you hang out with Brenda, she'll put the whirly on you. She'll get that, get them grave clothes. How many of you when you got born again, but the devil's always trying to tell you that, yeah, but you still wrapped up in this, and you still wrapped up in that, and you still, you know, we need big brothers and sisters to come along and say, nah, you ain't wrapped up in squat. All that's just... I just got to get this off of you. It don't belong on you no more. You were dead. Now you were a sinner. Now you a son of God. You were dead. Now you alive. Let's get this stuff off. It don't fit you no more. All right. So this compassion, this light that's in us, we're the light of the world. This love of God that's in us, it has an effect on people. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 6, it says, faith worketh by love. All you that cry out for more faith, you better be getting more love with it, or else your faith ain't going to do you a lot of good. Because faith works by love. You know, when somebody gets sick or somebody gets the hurting, don't you try to get people that know them to pray for them? Some of y'all just go to the leadership or whatever. I'm going to call the pastor. Man, I want to tell you something. Faith works by love. Find that mom and dad. Find that grandma. That woman loves that person more than me. I can pray the prayer of faith, but man, I want somebody that loves them because they'll keep praying. How many of you have ever prayed for somebody and you felt you did your Christian duty? Come on, be honest. They called you. You prayed. Did you pray the next day or the next day? No. And some hands went, what? Oh. Yeah. Some of it kind of slipped away. But you know, God's faithful. You pray. And I was going to say something about prayer. You don't have to. It's not like God's forgetful. We have to pray every day because he's like, something I was supposed to do yesterday. Excuse me, we're dealing with people in China. There's a lot of Chinese folks. We all been dealing with these. Yeah, I was dealing with an earthquake over in Panama. We don't have to remind him every day because he forgets. We prayed for you the other day, Simone, in our kitchen. And that was the end of it. Been thanking him ever since. When you pray, you ask God to do something. But see, when you believe it, you start praising him for it. Some of y'all wait till the praise report comes in, then you start praising. You're a little late. If you wait till you see it to believe it, oh Thomas, man of faith and power, you're missing it. Faith says, I prayed, I asked God, I know it's his will, I'm gonna start praising you for it. Thank you, Lord, that this thing in Simone's head is shrinking. Thank you, Lord, that it's not even gonna take surgery. Thank you that the doctors are going to be amazed. Thank you, Lord, there's no paralysis. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. not oh God in heaven. See, some of y'all think you got to work up some kind of manifestation of emotion to move God. Emotion don't move God. Faith does. You can have all the emotions in the world. You know, sometimes emotions are manifestations of doubt and unbelief. How many of fear has a look? Hey, can you pray? I need to be praying for my wife. She's got cancer. And you go, oh, God, cancer? I'll pray. When I get that response, I'm going, time out. Never mind. Don't even bother. Don't even bother. Don't even want your prayers. You don't want somebody over there, oh, God. Lord, don't take her. Take her? I don't even want those kind of prayers. You'll spend 20 minutes or an hour weeping and gnashing teeth and crying. I got Kleenex slung everywhere. Made a big mess and thinking God's like, well, I'm really moved by that. He's not moved by fear and doubt and unbelief. He's moved by faith. Jesus didn't bawl and squall resurrecting Lazarus. He just said, Lazarus, come forth. In fact, he says, I've already prayed about this. But for your sake, I'm going to pray again. Because they needed to hear him say something. You know, well, that brings to my mind, Brother Mike, how come we don't start every meeting off with prayer? Well, the Bible says when two or more gather in his name, he's here, isn't he? Do we need to tell him to get here? Does he think he missed that one? Last I checked, he wrote it down for us. See, people, be careful that we don't do things out of rituals. We don't do things out because everybody else does. Man, I come in this building with an expectation. Sometimes we act like we have to tell God what to do, like he don't know what to do. I like him to surprise us. Sometimes you got a list what you want him to do. Don't you love it when God does? How many of y'all like Christmas? Because you get stuff. Bottom line, you get stuff. You don't tell them, oh, I don't care about stuff. Yes, you do. Oh, I really don't. Well, then give it to me. Give it to me, and I'll take it, and you just carry on. We like it because people give us things. We celebrate. We have eggnog. We do things. I love the holiday seasons. It's the most wonderful time of the year. It is. I love Christmas time. The holiday season's starting. Man, Stater Brothers, they got a Christmas tree with, I don't know how they're mixing all this together, but they got a Christmas tree with little pumpkin guys, and it's like, we're going to put Halloween and Thanksgiving and Christmas all on one tree. It's like, okay, whatever, marketing. It's where the candy is. Now, here's the thing. We call this the holiday season. Why? Because we fellowship one another. We slow down. We take time. We think about people. We give gifts to one another. It's a wonderful time. Amen? I mean, oh, God likes Christmas. I know some Christians don't celebrate Christmas because it's a pagan holiday or whatever. Well, I've been there, done that, did that for a while, found out there was no life on it, went back to celebrating it because I felt God was not as religious as I was. I'm telling you, it's a revelation when you get a revelation sometimes of how God is not as religious as you and I think he should be. Hallelujah. I don't know if y'all noticed, I got Christmas lights down in my driveway year round. You're that guy on the highway with all the lights down there? That's me. They're not colorful lights, they're all just white lights. I got some class. Actually, that's twofold because I've missed that driveway coming home many times. It's just like, I know it's right here. Oh, there it was. Oh, man. So I got a word of knowledge and put lights down there. Now I know where my driveway is when it's dark at night. Yeah. So you go, well, that's wasting electricity. You're not a good steward. Hey, got you covered. They're LEDs. LEDs. They don't take hardly any juice at all. Hello. I think they're pretty. Yeah, you got lights in your trees. Yep, those are my avatar lights. Got my tree all lit up looking for it. Looks nice. That's just weird. I didn't know that was your house. Oh, my gosh. You're that guy. man. My grandkids think Grandpa's house is cool. Grandpa thinks his house is cool. When you move, you're going to take your lights? Oh, you better believe it. You're going to put them up at your next place? Oh, you better believe it. House, yeah, that's right. We're going to find out where the party is. Okay, I was going to start with this little story. Why do we like Christmas this time of year? Gifts. Because we manifest love for one another. Not just in the gifts, but we slow down. We go to people's houses. We sing songs together. We make time for each other. Thanksgiving. It's really wonderful that day when you go riding. If you've ever had to go to the store on Thanksgiving, shame, shame, know your name. Because most of us are supposed to have all that stuff ahead of time, but there's somebody out there going, oh my gosh, more Aunt Margaret's coming and her crew? Oh Lordy, we're going to need to, so you go get some more stuff. But if you're ever riding around on Thanksgiving Day, there's very little traffic on the day, actually. But as you go by, you see something very wonderful. You see houses with lots of cars in people's driveways. And I don't know about you, that makes me happy. That tells me families are getting together and they're breaking bread and they're doing what the Bible says we should do on a regular basis. But thank God, at least we do it once a year. I'm sure people do it more than that. But at least one day a year we set aside and say, hey, we're giving thanks for all the things that God has done for us. What if they're heathens? What if they're not? What if it's just about the game and the food? Well, even when, aren't y'all happy when people still do something that's good because God's ordained it? Whether they acknowledge God or not, at least they're doing something. They're moving toward the light. Hallelujah. Well, faith works by love. So I want you to have love, and that's great. I want you to have faith, that's great. But more than that, I want you to have love because love makes faith work. How does love act during trials? This is where the rubber's going to hit the road. This is why we need love, people. How does love act during a trial? Well, I'll tell you. There was a man that he's known in the Bible for having some of the worst trials anybody else has ever had in the history of mankind. What's his name? Job. See, y'all knew it. Mr. Job. No, the guy named Job, Apple. Yeah, well, this is Job. He's before him. All right, so this guy, Job, got it going on. He's blessed, got kids, got he's prospering. He's a happy camper. Satan's mad, tells God one day, he's only blessed because the only reason he's happy is because he's blessed. If I could get to his stuff, he'd curse you. I love the conversation they have in Job chapter 1. It says Lucifer tells God, he said, you got him hedged up. You got him so protected, I can't get to him. Now, if an Old Testament saint can get to a place in God where the devil can't touch him, do you think that's possible for the New Testament church? Do you think we can find a place in Christ? Jesus said that wicked one comes and has nothing in me. Jesus knew how to do it. Is that possible? If an Old Testament saint can do it, it's more than possible enough. In the Old Testament, the Spirit of God came upon them at times. In the New Testament, the Spirit of God dwells and lives in us. That's far better than it coming on you periodically. It said the Spirit of the Lord came upon Samson and he killed the Philistine. The Spirit of the Lord came upon Samson and he ripped the gates off the city. The Spirit of the Lord came upon, you know, Samson didn't walk around some no-neck, big, bulky guy. Looked like he'd been hanging out at Venice Beach. Hey, how's it going? It says the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. He caught 300 foxes one night. 300 days I could chase foxes and never catch one on foot. He caught 300 in one night. Lit their tails on fire and burned up the Philistines' crop. God's got a sense of humor, people. Quit reading the scriptures like, yeah, that's... I'm looking for the deeper manifestation of this scripture. God's like, I just thought it was funny to watch all these foxes go around. Anyway, Spirit of the Lord would come upon him. Dwells in us. So Job's sitting out there, got it all going on. And God says, Lucifer, if I could just get to him, he'd deny you. God says, okay, just don't kill him. And in one day, he loses all his cattle, camels, donkeys, his crops. In one day. And then all his children. That is a lot. The man was financially devastated, but more than that, he was emotionally devastated because he lost something far greater than wealth. He lost his children. They're all at his son's house. The house collapsed, killed everybody in the house. And if you notice the story, it says, while this guy was telling him about, hey, these guys came and they took all your cattle, it says, while he was still speaking, another guy came up. I mean, he got all this news. And literally just a few minutes. It says, while he was yet speaking, another came. While he was yet speaking, another came. This isn't like it started at 6 in the morning. By 6 at night, all this stuff had happened. He gets hit with everything he loved and cared dear for and worked so hard for. He lost it all in the course of just 5 minutes. He heard he lost everything. Now, people, that's one of the most serious devastations a person can go through. How did he respond? He went in the house, he shaved his head, put on some really cheap clothes, sackcloth and ashes, went out and sat in the dirt, and began to praise God. It says he went out and worshiped. And said, the Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. There's love responding. You see, how can a man do that? Well, man can't. But a man that's in covenant with God. Because do you know what God did in that moment? When, how many know that he's the God of all comfort? When you're going through a trial, do you ever feel like you're going through it by yourself? You may feel that way, but is it true? Isaiah said, when you go through the rivers and through the floods and through the fires, I'll go through it with you. You never go through a trial by yourself, people, if you're a child of God. Never. I feel like, though, Brother Mike, I feel like I'm all alone. Think Job felt all alone? His wife come out and said, man, why don't you just curse God and die? He didn't even have the support of his helpmeet. Thanks, babe. I've got kind of a lot of stuff going on right here. Why don't you just curse God and die? No, I'm not giving up. Did the man have cause to give up? Sounds like to me he did. Did he give up? I'll tell you something. You never lose. If you go through a trial, as long as you don't give up, you win. You hear that? As long as you don't give up, you win. I don't care how bad it gets. Don't give up, because the scripture says you'll get through it. You'll reap if you faint not. If you don't quit, give up, you'll get through this. This too shall pass. Just don't give up on God. Don't get mad at God. Listen to this statement. It's never God's fault. If something's going wrong in your life, you might need to slow down. You could have done something to set this in motion. If you're limping real bad, you might want to look. Oh, my goodness, I shot my foot. If you had a bullet hole there and your gun is smoking on the side of your leg, that was your fault. I don't know why I'm limping so bad. God, what did you do? God didn't do nothing. How many of we've all shot our foot? This is really the gun right here. And that's not some holster over here. This is the gun that can shoot your foot and your neighbor's foot and everybody else around you. The Bible says this guy right here is a world of iniquity. It says that the tongue is set on fire by hell. Not heaven, hell. It says when this thing gets to going, it's hard to put it out. You ever walk outside on them windy days and you say to yourself, man, I hope nobody's stupid today. Nobody tries to burn trash or something dumb, because this would be a bad day to have a fire. Every time it's windy, I think like that. Lord, please let everybody be smart. Because when it's wind and everything's dry, that's all it needs. We've all experienced fires out here. Because once they get started and the wind's blowing, it's hard to put them out. Sometimes when this thing gets going, it's hard to shut it up. Some of us have 22 caliber. That means it's a small bullet. They don't mean it can't kill you. It just takes a lot more of them. Some of us got shotgun mouths. It's one blast that's just devastating. We just know what to say to devastate people. Some of us are machine guns. It's like you can't even retaliate because the words are coming so fast. This thing right here. The Bible says when you get control of your tongue, the Bible calls it a perfect man. When you can bridle this guy, you're stepping into some serious maturity. Because this thing here, you ever feel like your mouth and your tongue has a mind of its own? It just kind of bypasses your brain and your heart and the rest of you. And it's like, because your mind will tell you, you really shouldn't say that. And your mouth will say, shut it. I'm just going to say this one thing. And it lies. Because it never says one thing. It just, and this. Well, because once they start falling down, we go, this feels good. And it's sad that it feels good because it shouldn't feel good. Because you know what? If you've ever been on the end of that thing, it don't feel good. When somebody's doing it to you, it sure don't feel good when you're doing it to them. Sometimes when you don't know what to say, the best thing is to say nothing. Well, I feel like I need to respond. No, you don't. If you can't, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are a good report, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are honest, if there be any virtue, there be any praise, think on these things. You know, if we thought before we spoke, we would be far better down the road. The Bible tells us what to speak. But sometimes, brother, I can't help it. Yes, you can. As long as you make excuses for your soul, like you got no control, that won't wash with God. When you're a babe in Christ, we've all said things when we're babes, just like babies say things when they don't make sense. We don't ever yell at kids. They're going, yeah, and you're going, quit crying. Tell me what you want. Hey, she's 6 weeks old. She can't tell you what you want. We've all been babes in Christ, but there comes a time, you know, as people get older, we expect them to communicate and tell us. God expects as we get older and mature to communicate and tell them. All right. How does love act in trials? Well, it worships. It gives God praise. It doesn't accuse. It says in all that Job went through, he never charged God foolishly. One thing love does, it doesn't charge God foolishly. Take God off the top of your list when you want to start blaming somebody for what's going on in your life. I would suggest that you put your name up there. Let it start with you. Say, Lord, I know it's not you. If I've got off the path here, if I'm in the ditch, you know that there's a ditch on both sides of the road. You ever seen people go into the ditch and then they get out and they only just go across the street to get on the other side of the ditch? Some of them, that's their walk in God. They're moving forward, but they're it's like, oh my goodness. Learn to walk straight. And if you have trouble walking straight, find somebody that is and follow behind them. Quit going in back from one ditch to the other. Hallelujah. Man, this Christian walk is so hard. Yeah, in the ditch. But the road is not that hard. Stay out of the ditch. All the people I run with are ditch people. Word of the Lord, ditch them. get on the road and stay away from them. I don't run with people that every week it's a disaster. There are in this world, you'll have tribulations. You're going to have trials. It's part of it, but it's not a way of life. You go through seasons where you go through the wilderness. You do go through trials. You do go through. It's part of the walk. Jesus was water baptized, came up out of the water. He was led by the Spirit into the wilderness right after his baptism. Woohoo, had an experience with God. Dove comes down from heaven, woohoo, lands on his shoulder. My beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. Hallelujah, tells him, ooh, just got a confirmation from God. He's well pleased. Next journey, next turn the page, where's he at? In the wilderness. Did he sin? No. Did he do something wrong? No. He was led by the Spirit into the wilderness for what? To be tested by the enemy. People, we all get tested by the enemy. That's part of it. Do you know everybody gets tested? Have you not read at the end of the book in Revelation that there's a group of people that are born during the millennial reign? Yeah, it says it. There's people born during that time. And the devil, where's the devil? He's bound in the bottomless pit for how long? 1,000 years. So for 1,000 years during this millennial reign, there is no lust, greed, anger, depression, whatever, because there's no devil to put that out. But at the end of this book, there's a little section that says that the Lucifer's loosed out of the bottomless pit, and for a season, it says season, that could be literally 3 months or a short period of time. And he goes around tempting all these people that were born during that time. Why? Everybody goes through trials. Everybody has to be tempted, and everybody has to choose whether you're going to serve God or serve yourself or the devil. Well, here's people that were born, and these guys are almost 1,000 years old. If they were born at the beginning of the millennial reign, they're 999 years, man. They're 1,000 years old. Been living in the world where Jesus is king. There's no war. There's no famine. There's no disease. There's no. It's utopia. It's one. It's the Garden of Eden all over again. On the news. Tomorrow Lucifer will be bound out of the bottomless pit. Be loosed. It's been down there for 1,000 years. So you that have not been tempted, get ready. It's going to happen tomorrow. They're not even going to be surprised. And some guys wake up the next day and they're walking down the street and there's a little voice that says, "Hey, check her out." He never heard "check her out." He never heard, "Hey, how you doing?" Never there. That day, there it is. "Hey, how you doing?" Where's that coming from? Now he has to make a choice. Do I submit myself to King Jesus? He told me this would happen one day. Here it is. In fact, he told me yesterday on the news it was going to happen today. I'm telling you, people, these are the stupidest people in the world. Because it says that some of them give in. After living on earth for 1,000 years with Jesus, they give in. They don't deserve to live with us in heaven. I'm telling you, Keith, don't want to live with people that are that dumb. 1,000 years you had peace, prosperity. It was wonderful. You get tempted. You were told you were going to be tempted. You know it's the outcome of the enemy. There was prayer in school. You can't say they took prayer out of school. They took Bible reading out of school. That's all they do in school. It's all about God. These people aren't being deceived without knowledge. They have knowledge. They're just being tempted like you and me, and they're making a choice. And some, it says, choose, and they go with the devil. And it says after that season, that's it. And then we go to heaven. I thought you died, you went to heaven. No, heaven's a good ways down the road. Then there's a new city. There's a new city. Amen? There's a city whose maker and builder is God. It's called the New Jerusalem. It comes down on a new heaven and new earth. That's, you see, some of y'all going, "Man, I hope I don't mess up during that millennial reign." I want to tell you something. I got news for you. You won't. You know why? You'll have glorified bodies. Blessed is he that hath part in the first resurrection. You make the rapture, you make the first resurrection, you're safe. You're safe. You can't be subject to that kind of stuff. You won't fall after that point. You'll have eaten from the tree of life. Hello? But there's people that never have experience that. Amen? They'll be saved. They'll believe in Jesus, but they never have been tempted or tried, never been tested. We all got to get tested. All right. How does love act during this stuff? Well, two more verses. We're doing good, y'all. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Verse 8. We are troubled on every side. You ever feel like that? Yet not distressed. I love the response back. Yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Perplexed means you don't know how it's going. You don't know how to fix it. There's no perplexities or problems that there really are no solutions. You just don't know what to do. We are perplexed, but we're not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Now, that's how love responds during trials. It doesn't say we are troubled on every side, so we give up. But we're not distressed. We are perplexed. We don't know what to do, so we murmur and complain. We're persecuted, so we run. God's forsaken us. No, it says we're persecuted, but we're not forsaken. We're cast down, but not destroyed. Everybody in this room has been cast down at one time or another. But you know what? It's not a sin to fall down. It's a sin to stay down. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, though he fall. Now, this is God talking. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, though he fall. What? God, you act like you think, like you know we're going to fall. God's going, duh. Why do you think I sent you a Savior? Because I know you're going to fall. Though he falls, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord will uphold him with his hand. Who picks you up when you fall down? God. Now, I'll tell you something, Christian. If you ever found guilty kicking somebody when they're down, shame on you. There's a scripture in Psalms that says, God will not abhor us in our affliction. What does that mean? Abhor us. God won't kick you when you're down. That is not the nature of God. I've had Christians not only kick me, throw stones and spit and everything else. That is not, when I say Christians, they were Christians, but they were not being very Christ-like. Let me tell you something. Just because you're a Christian doesn't mean you can't respond the way you want to. Christian means Christ-like. That don't mean everything that you do, you respond like Christ. You always have free will. You always have a choice. But Bible says, let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. If you're going to be a Christian, then you better start acting, sounding like, talking like, finding out how Jesus wants you to respond and start responding accordingly. You should want to. I love the simplicity of the scripture. Yeah, there's so many verses, but I'm like, I don't know how to do it all. I'll help you out here. Just do two. Just two commandments. Two. Just love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. Upon these two commandments hang the whole law and the prophets. If that isn't simple enough, how about one? One. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. You don't want people talking about you. You don't want people kicking you when you're down. Don't kick people when they're down. You want people to be there when you're going through trials. Be there when people are going through trials. You do to others as you'd want people to do to you. That's what Jesus said. Yeah, I think that's like the golden rule, isn't it? Yeah, I did. We call it that, but that's what Jesus would do. What would Jesus do? He did to others as the Father told him, as he'd want them to do to him. Amen. Well, one more verse. Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. Verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God. Isn't that awesome? Through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have access by faith into the grace wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. You know, the grace of God is what caused us to come together and assemble this morning. Grace is the desire and power to do the will of God. Aren't you glad there's grace on your life right now? I want to tell you something. When the grace lifts, you'll know. You ever been helping somebody? As long as you had grace to do it, it was okay, wasn't it? Did you notice when the grace started lifting? Did you realize it got difficult and more difficult? And at some point, it can get unbearable. If you don't have the grace, if God isn't giving you the grace to do the thing you're doing, you better not be doing it. Because it will kill you. Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God. Grace is not some mystic little pixie dust that kind of goes before us, or some little fog that we walk around in. I'm in the grace of God. It's the desire and power to do the will of God. Unmerited favor. If you don't have the favor of God on it, you can't do it. If he don't give you the desire, see, when God can take away those desires. I've helped people with grace. But when the grace starts lifting, you better start making that adjustment. You better start telling them, I've done all I can do. You're going to have to do something else. Well, I just can't turn them out on the streets. You better learn to do what the Lord says you can do. Because if you start helping people doing things beyond grace, it will cost you. And I call it the Jonah syndrome. I mean, you know the story of Jonah. He's on this boat. God tells him to go to Nineveh and tell the people to repent. He don't like the Ninevites. He says, hey, if I don't go to Nineveh and they don't repent, God's going to destroy them. That's what he told me. He said, I'm going to destroy them. Go tell them repent. I won't tell them. You'll destroy them. Yeah, we get rid of our enemies. I mean, that wasn't a good thing. Jonah went down and got a boat going the opposite direction. He just thought he'd make himself unavailable to God. King David said, if I go to the depths of the sea, thou art there. If I hide myself in the cliffs of the rocks, thou art there. You can't hide from God. If God ever says, want to play hide and go seek, just surrender right there and say, you win. I give up. Because he knows wherever you're hiding, he's going to find you. Jonah's in this boat. He's down there sleeping. A big wave, a storm comes. And they start throwing stuff overboard. And they go down there and wake Jonah up and say, Jonah, seek God. We're trying to find out what's going on. You know, we believe this is a judgment. Jonah's going, I know what's going on. It's my God's after me. He knew. He didn't try to hide it. Oh, yeah, okay, I'll pray. He goes, it's me. And they got up there and they still started throwing stuff overboard and stuff. And they couldn't get out due to the storm. And at one point, Jonah said, just throw me overboard. And no sense you guys all dying. You know, some people would rather die than do the will of God. Isn't that crazy? And as soon as they threw Jonah overboard, the sea stopped. It got calm. Now, how many of y'all think that maybe you ought to get that life jacket and that preserver and throw it to him? Hey, it could have been just a freak of nature. It could have just been a weird storm. Am I the only guy that thinks that way? We threw a guy overboard and now it's calm. How about we save him? I mean, God knew that. I think the guys are heading for the life preserves to go throw a lifeline to this man, but God had a fish and come up and swallowed him. And the guy's going, ooh, never mind. That answered it for me. That must have been God. Shame on you, buddy. Bro. Now here's what, so why do you call it the Jonah syndrome? If you're helping people that are under the judgment of God and they're running from God, their sin can affect you. It says they begin to lose their wares. If you're helping somebody God don't want you help, are there people that God don't want you to help? Yes, sir. I mean, God lets us sometimes come to the end of ourselves. No, we mean sometimes. Hello? The prodigal son's dad didn't get in the chariot and go look for his son in pig pens. It said it didn't find him at McDonald's farm. Didn't have put out missing posters all around the neighborhood. He went looking for him. He didn't go looking for him. Excuse me. He waited till his son got to the end of himself. His son came home. He was looking for him, but he didn't go out looking for him. How many of y'all came to Christ when you came to end of yourself? How many of y'all had to hit the old pig pen before you realized, this is not working out? Yeah. Well, just me. And my brother boatman. Thank you, Jesus. Two fellas in a ship, bro. Yeah, we had to come to the end of ourselves. God lets that happen. Hallelujah. By whom we have access through faith in the grace of God, whereby we stand and rejoice in the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations. What? Knowing. You got to know this. Listen, it says knowing something's going to happen when you go through a trial. This is what I said. How does love act in the trial? Well, we go through trials. It says we rejoice in tribulations, knowing that tribulation works patience. Man, I wish I had more patience. I can tell you how you can get more patience. Go through those trials. Some of y'all, every time you go through a trial, you try to get out of it quicker than need be, and you don't get the patience that comes with that trial. Knowing that tribulation works patience or endurance, and patience or endurance experience, because it takes time to get experiences. How many of y'all have some experiences on your belt? I've had some healings in my life. I've had some relationship breakups. I know what that feels like to have your heart broken. I know what it feels like to have God restored. I've had children. I've had prodigals. I've had prodigals come home. I've had all kinds of experiences, and those experiences are what I help other people with. You ever talk to people that never had any experiences in life? When you go, you know how it is when you're in the hospital and you got no hope? Never been in the hospital. You know, when you're just financially devastated? I mean, I'm infinitely wealthy. You know, when people just give up on you, walk away and reject you? I got more friends to know what to do with. I mean, this is not the guy you want to be talking to. You just want to go, you know what? Go. I can't relate to you on any level. You're a no comfort at all. All right, knowing that tribulation works patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. These experiences we go through, Miss Joan, give us hope, and not only us, they give other people hope. Because when Simone gets through this thing with this whole tumor thing, and she survives, and not only survives, but lives, when some person comes up and says, hey, I got a tumor in my body, you go, hey, been there, done that. What happened? I prayed, God fixed it. Well, it's inoperable. Man, mine was too. What'd you do? I trusted God for the end result. They did operate and got some of it, but it was wrapped around this part in my head that if they did any more cutting, I could have been paralyzed. And my husband called it. It was a 19-hour surgery. That's a long time. They come out and say, look, if we keep cutting, we didn't get it all, but if we keep cutting, she may be paralyzed. And Mike said, no, stop. That's enough then. We'll just trust God for the rest. Aren't you glad you got, when the doctor says, this is all we can do, but if we don't get it all, it could come back. Turns out it's not grown any since. Hello? Wow, what a quinkadink. That sure is coincidental. Not coincidental at all. We're praying that way. We're not only praying that it don't grow, we're praying that it shrinks. We give people hope. Keep reading. And hope maketh not, or keeps making, not ashamed. One translation says, a hope that never disappoints. Any of y'all ever been disappointed by God? I didn't say, have you ever been disappointed? We've all been disappointed. But have you ever been disappointed by God? See, God can't, he cannot disappoint you, because that means he would have to be disappointed. You have to fail. And God can't fail. Hallelujah. And a hope that never disappoints. Hope that makes us not ashamed. Why? Because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts. One translation says, poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, which is given to us. Why don't we get disappointed? Because God pours out love in you. And this love gives you the ability to do anything. Love is the most powerful thing God has ever equipped you with.
I have the sword of the Spirit. I have the shield of faith. I have the Holy Ghost flamethrower. I have the hand grenades of God. I have the bazooka of blessing.
Okay. We have the love of God poured out in our hearts.
I need more love, God.
God says, why are you asking for something that I've said I would pour out in your heart? Now hear that. Lord just said, say it right. I'm going to slow down here. Did y'all not see a pattern? We go through trials. These trials work experiences. These experiences give us hope. This hope gives other people hope. But through all this, what happens? The love of God is poured out. You know that you go through these trials. What does that do? It gives you more love. See, sometimes we want God to pour love into us without any connection or any relating to anybody, without trials and tribulations and things. And guys, that kind of love is weird. I just gave you a little story of a guy, or I made up a story of a guy that just can't relate because he's never had any problems. I want the guy that's been there, done that. Paul said, I bear the marks of Christ in my body. What does that mean? Paul said, you know, I know I love Jesus. He could take his robe and drop it, and he could show you his back, and you could see the scars where he was beat because he loved Jesus. He wouldn't shut up. Where he was beat with rods because he loved Jesus. He said, I bear. How many of y'all, you and I have scars? When you've had a son or a daughter out there on drugs and they're just messing up and your heart's been broken so many times that you can't hardly believe it's ever going to be normal. And then God shows up and that child comes home. Amen. He just comes home and says, hey, I'm done. We've prayed. We've done everything. They've been in every rehab program. They've done everything under the sun. None the better. And then all of a sudden they have an encounter with God. And they come home. And we go, man. But see, what happened? You hung in there with God. What's the other alternative? Give up? Get mad at God? Scratch him off the list? Then you're on your own.
I feel like I'm on my own anyways.
Wah, wah, wah. The word says you're not.
Yeah, but I feel like I am.
The word says you're not.
Yeah, but I feel like I am.
But the word says you're not. We can do this all day. But see, as long as you put more stock in your feelings than you do the word of God, then your feelings will win out. You know, at some point you got to say, you know what, feelings, you're a liar. Because Jesus, but I feel alone. God said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. When I needed you the most, we've all seen that little plaque of, God, there were two sets of footprints in the sand. And when I was going through the worst time, there was only one set of prints. Oh, my gosh, you left me in my time of need. And he goes, no, there's one set of prints because that's when I carried you. He ain't never forsaken you, people, or me. But get to the other side. How many of y'all feel like you've gone through certain trials over and over? Well, I'm going to tell you why. You ain't passed it yet. In school, do you have to take certain tests over and over? Hey, the driving test. Have you had not take that over and over? I knew a kid one time that studied the test and not the book. There's only four tests. He had to take all four of them because he studied the test and not the book. How many of we should study the book? Otherwise, you're going to keep going through these same. Isn't that cool how God worked that out? These things just come to me, Keith. I don't plan them. They're not on paper, man. They just come to me. We need to study the book so we can pass the test. Otherwise, we're going to keep going through these same wildernesses. That the Israelites, 40 years in the same wilderness. Why? Were they lost? No, they were following God. Why did it take them 40 years? Because they quit. They wouldn't quit complaining. They wouldn't quit murmuring. They wouldn't quit. Well, that was the main thing. You murmur and complain, you'll just wander in the wilderness. You got to stop and be thankful. How many of y'all thankful for where you live right now? I don't care if it's an apartment. I don't care if it's a trailer. I don't care where you live. I don't care if it's a tent. I lived in a tent for a while. You know what? I had just as much fun in that tent as I did in my house. Happiness is where your heart is. It's not the building you're in. So start being happy where you're at. I'll be happy when. See, that's why you keep going through that same wilderness. I'll be happy when I get a new car. How about be happy that you have a car? My car gives me all kinds of problems. Thank God you can walk. You'll be on a bicycle if you don't quit complaining. Amen? Out of the pan, into the fire, out of the fire, into the volcano. It can get worse. Don't think it can. It can. So stop complaining and just praise God. Do like Job did. Bless him. Worship him. Praise him. Praise will take you out of that valley, out of that problem, out of that wilderness. Praise him. Lord, I'm not alone. Your word says I'm not. I don't care what I feel. Your word says I'm not alone. You'll never leave me or forsake me. You always will meet my needs according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Always. So stand on his word. Amen? Your greatest weapon is love. In these last days, the way you blow the trumpet, we're all going through trials. You know, they say that there's a big earthquake coming. Not just they. NASA, about a year ago, said that Southern California is going to experience a major earthquake. They're 99.9% sure it's going to happen in the next 2 years. That was a year ago. So probably sometime this next year, a big shaker's coming. Now, I'll tell you something, folks. That's going to affect a lot of us. Your home could collapse. My home could collapse. But you know what? I hope you can walk outside. And if you see a pile of rubble, that you say, the Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. See, it's easy to praise God when everything's going your way. But see, the world, the neighbors are all, wow, you lost your house. It's how you act during that time that'll determine whether the seeds of the gospel you planted in their hearts will really grow during that season. The light shines the brightest in darkness. You realize a major earthquake in Southern California will bring a lot of darkness. It'll bring despair. It'll bring confusion. It'll bring a lot of darkness. It'll bring the best out in some people, the worst in others. People will riot and loot and all kinds of stuff. Others will bend over backwards to help people. But it's in that hour that we get to, that light gets to shine the brightest. Your light is your love. So we got a test coming. Amen. Bob Jones, prophet of God, before he died, prophesied. I'm going to tell you what he prophesied. He prophesied the movie. I saw the movie, and it's word for word what he prophesied. The movie San Andreas. It's a movie. Rent it. It's kind of entertaining. I went and saw it. He prophesied that what's in that movie would come to pass. A major earthquake in Southern California. He said, I saw Boulder Dam break. In the movie, it breaks and floods. I mean, I watched this thing and I had read that prophecy and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, Hollywood is prophesying. And people still just being entertained by it, not listening. It's coming. So what are we going to do? The rest of the country is getting flooded. Louisiana's up to their waist. Why is everybody else can go through trials, but we get a little, long as we have fires, but long as they don't touch us, we're okay. Amen? Some things are going to happen, folks. We're going to get shaken just like everybody else. And we get the same opportunity to say, well, blessed be the name of the Lord. Or, oh, I can't believe this happened to me. God, I serve you. What's the problem, God? You got two responses. You can either blame him or thank him. Do you realize why is, well, let's pray that this earthquake don't come. Do you know why God allows famine, earthquakes, all this pestilence and stuff, which it says in the Bible will happen in the last days? You know why he has to do that? He has to get people's attention. Do you realize people don't think they need God in America right now? Till their house is underwater, all of a sudden, And all of a sudden now they need God. How many of y'all in this room didn't need God until your life got to the point you couldn't take it anymore? Then all of a sudden God became kind of a something you need to check into. Jesus said in Matthew 24, in the last days, earthquakes in diverse places. They're all going to be all over the place. It's part of it. Amen? This means the scripture being fulfilled. Well, let it be fulfilled in Tennessee and Louisiana and other states. Don't let it be fulfilled out here. You know what? Revival breaks out a lot of times after these things happen. Do you remember when the fires came through? How many of y'all were here when the fires came through? Did you not see a unity that came about in our town that wasn't there before the fires? Y'all remember the staging over at Mountain View over there where people were going there to get the Tide truck that came in, people getting their laundry done? Wasn't that cool how people were helping each other out? This is when the church gets to shine their brightest. Do you know that every time there's a disaster, that Operation Blessing from the 700 Club, they go down to these places where earthquakes and stuff are happening. The Mennonite Church send people. That's how Alvin and Dave got to Southern California. They came out here during the fires to help people rebuild. Churches send people out during times like this to help people, and that's when the church shines the brightest. So these things do happen so we can go help people. You know, if your neighbor's house collapses but yours don't, you think you might want to go next door and say, hey, Larry, Margaret, y'all come on over, stay with us. You'd do that for us? Absolutely. That's when you get opportunity to show the love of God. The what? There it is again. Your light, the love of God. Well, what if they have to stay with us for a while? More reasons to show them the love of God. I don't mind passing out a track at the mall or something, but I don't want somebody coming to live with me. You know what? What if your house falls? And Larry says you can come live with him. Well, Brother Mike, Larry drinks beer like a tap. I don't know if I could live at Larry's house. You know, get over yourself. Amen. I'll go live with you. Live with Larry. Oh, that's funny. Oh, man. You got a sense of humor. So if my house collapses, I got to help somebody? Is that all you got out of this sermon? It's amazing what some people hear when I, what'd you hear today? I heard, I hope our house don't collapse because we got to take the neighbors in. I know. Let's just beef up our insurance, hope we get a big check, and we can live at a motel not to get involved with people. Yeah, that's the plan. Is that what you heard? I heard that the love of God is poured out in our hearts, and that's our power. And how do you blow the trumpet? How do you warn people? You walk in the love of God before the trial, during the trial, and after the trial. And much the more during the trial. That's what makes the world look at us and go, y'all are different. You're going through a tough time right now, Danielle. A tough time. But you know, this is a time the world's going to look at you and go, man, but you, I know your heart was hurting, but you still seem like you was okay. Well, I am okay because I was not alone. We all go through trials, people. It's how we go through them that the world looks at us and goes, y'all are different. I could not have survived that. I'd have gave up. I'd have quit. I don't know how you did what you did. And you look at them and say, it was Jesus. I didn't go through it alone. See, Jesus said everybody goes through trials. In this world, you shall have tribulation. That wasn't just to the church. That's everybody. When this earthquake comes, everybody's going to be shaken by it. Some are going to go through it alone. They're going to lose everything they've worked so hard for. And others, if they lose stuff, they didn't lose the thing that's most precious to them. My salvation is the greatest gift I have. Eternal life. That's what nobody can take that from me. Hallelujah. You can get another house. You can get another car. Amen. So be encouraged. Oh. He says, be encouraged. We got a major earthquake coming. I got to move in with neighbors. Man, what a bad sermon. That's all you heard. Help me. Pray for me. I thought I was a little more clear than that. Well, God is good, isn't he? Are you encouraged? Are you encouraged? All right, go out. They're made tacos out here today. You can go out there and have a taco with somebody and say, man, tell you what, brother, if your house collapses, go live with Brother Mike. Go out and break bread together. God bless you. We'll see you next week.